On behalf of the Institute of Mathematical Sciences, it is my honor to welcome our chief guest, Sri M. Venkaiah Naidu, Honorable Vice President of India, to the event today. We are delighted, sir, that you could accept our invitation and visit our institute. We are honored that the Honorable Minister for Higher Education, Government of Tamil Nadu, and Chairman Governing Board of IMSC, Thiru K.P. Anbarahan, is able to attend today's event. Thank you, sir, for attending the event today. We are very happy to welcome Selvi Apurva, IAS, Principal Secretary to Government of India, Higher Education Department, member of both IMSC Governing Board and the IMSC Executive Council. Thank you, madam, for attending the event today. It is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Arun Kumar Bhaduri, Distinguished Scientist and Director, Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation. My plan is to make a small presentation about the institute for you, and then we'll move on from there. So you can see you can watch the slides on the display here. So this is how the institute began. This is a historical slide from dated 1961, where you can see a meeting between the then Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru with the founding director Alladi Ramakrishnan. The institute was founded in 1962, early 1962, and the inaugural seminar was given by the famous astrophysicist S. Chandrasekhar. This is what the institute looked like in the late 1960s. And quickly fast forwarding, today we are a National Institute of Higher Learning focused on research in fundamental areas, frontier areas of mathematical and physical sciences. We are a grant and aid institute under the Department of Atomic Energy, Government of India, and also supported by the Government of Tamil Nadu. We have a strong PhD program of which we are very proud. Our students are placed as faculty members among the best institutes in India and also some of them abroad. We have a vibrant visitor program through the year, which where we have top academicians from all over the world and within the country, of course, visiting us, and there are many collaborative programs with them. That's a very important part of, because interaction, communication is a very important part of science. That's a very important feature of our institute. Our present faculty strength is 51. We are a small-sized institute, 15 in math, 23 in physics, 9 in computer science, and 4 in computational biology. The current PhD strength is about 120, and we have 35 postdoctoral fellows. And we have a very meager non-academic staff of 30 administrative members and 7 technical members who work like 100. So, and this is a present-day picture of the institute. You can see it's all lush and green. Our principal areas of research are mathematics, theoretical physics, computer science, and computational biology. I have listed down all the different sub-fields in these disciplines in which research is conducted in the institute. But what I'm going to do is to give you a very, very brief snapshot of some highlights, research highlights, which are easy for me to describe to. So the first set of highlights that I picked up is from mathematical modeling and network science. Was the Indus Valley script written from left to right? That is an interesting question. It turns out, as research shows, done by IMSC members, by analyzing the frequency distribution of the letters when the words are formed, see, what we could figure out was that at the beginning of the word, the entropy, the uncertainty is very high. It's an intuitive thing, but it's also been empirically tested across all languages. So it seems to be a universal property of languages. At the beginning of every word, the entropy is high, and as you build the word, the entropy gradually drops. This is what you would expect, because the word gets more and more determined as you form the word. So this has been statistically analyzed in the case of all these natural languages. And without understanding the Indus Valley script, we could do a similar statistical analysis and prove that it was actually written from right to left, which is very interesting. And it's supported by the current archaeological evidence as well. So it's like a mathematical verification of the archaeological evidence. So this piece of research drew a lot of media attention and also won a lot of international attention.
How it underwent change?
Sorry?
How it underwent change?
That is a very interesting question. It seems like the Indus Valley civilization seemed to have had a script similar to the Sumerian and Mesopotamian civilizations, and at some point of time it changed from left to right. That's a very interesting point, and it's not well understood. The next thing that I want to mention is one IMSC member's amazing effort along with summer students to create an Indian medicinal plants database with now over 10,000 phytochemicals. And the database actually reveals the molecular structure of these phytochemicals, which makes it amenable to what is called virtual screening by a computer program, which will enable drug discovery. So a lot of big pharma companies are interested in this database, and this has drawn media attention from both India and abroad. The same group has built a similar database for harmful chemicals, what are called endocrine disruptor chemicals. And both these databases are copyrighted, the design is copyrighted, and they're there. The third point that I want to highlight is mathematical disease modeling, in which IMSC has been working for over 10 years now. There is the key thing here is that the group interacts with biologists, clinicians, public health specialists from various hospitals in Chennai and also outside. And one of our faculty members is a member of the public working health group set up by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare during the COVID pandemic. His model did a very accurate prediction of the R0 value both before the initial and after the initial lockdown phases, and the numbers that he predicted pretty much matched the actual data. I should also mention here that the IMSC has an extremely strong science communication group. We are very passionate about talking about science to everybody. And as soon as the COVID epidemic broke out, our science communication group swung into action. They immediately wrote articles, not just in English, but also in Tamil, created posters, shared it with the Tamil Nadu Science Forum so that it could readily be distributed among rural areas. And even recently, there has been an event conducted by the Tamil Nadu Science Forum, basically our members leading the event, which was on COVID. So, and that has been very useful, I think, in creating public awareness and knowledge among the people about what viral diseases are and how they spread and so on. Moving on, I'll say something about high energy physics. High energy physics is essentially all about mega science. The study of fundamental particles on the very small scale on the one hand, and huge objects like stars and galaxies on the other hand. So both these extremes require a lot of energy in order to generate experimental data. Small particle physics, which looks at experimental data and makes physics predictions, is called phenomenology. And the data is obtained from these mega science projects, which are these huge accelerators in CERN and the KEK in Japan and so on. That is on the one hand. On the other hand, astrophysics uses experimental data generated by modern telescopes and space missions, which are also very expensive mega science projects. Luckily, we have a well-established group in phenomenology, which has access to this data, and they're able to do sophisticated physics, which is well recognized. We have a younger group in astrophysics, which is also able to have access to this data by being part of the consortias, and they have access to it, and they're able to do good physics. The third one that I want to mention is what Professor Indumati explained outside. It is our own mega science project, the India-based Neutrino Observatory. When we manage to build this, we will be building our own, we will be the center of this project, and which will have a huge impact on the way science is done in India, and it will produce a huge number of young researchers and give them a big push in the field. So I think I should quickly run over because of the shortage of time. So this was a slide on the other extreme of physics of everyday matter. It's possible to use statistical mechanics and computer simulations to design materials like concrete and gels and paste and so on. So instead of doing trial and error, wasting material, you can do everything on the computer and create the material later. Similarly, drug discovery by doing molecular dynamic analysis, the way polymers interact with cell membranes, you can study that and figure out what is the design, what is the best polymer to transport the drug to inside cells. So we have collaborations in both these fields with at international and national level, like Tata Memorial Center, the Cancer Institute of DE, we have a collaboration on that as well. I'd like to fast forward now because we are short on time. This is the high performance computing machine that we use to do all these simulations and experiments. And we have a lot of expertise in it. I don't have time to explain these things, so I'll just fast forward a little bit. Oh, okay. Maybe then I'll tell you something about, I'll tell you something. Okay. Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. So the first item here, so this is research highlights in mathematics. So pure mathematics is, of course, ideal mathematics. And that is what drives the imagination of young people in the country. You know, people want to do pure mathematics because there is a charm and romance about it. People think of Ramanujan. So here is one field which is called contact geometry. So the idea here is that there are geometrical structures in the real world which are different from the way we imagine three-dimensional geometry, visual geometry as we see it. The real world is not like north, south, east, west, up and down. That is Euclidean geometry. As I explained to you outside, the Einstein field equation, space is actually curved and light bends under gravity. So the real world geometry is it's quite different, it's much more complicated. So one such geometry is contact geometry, and IMSC has done outstanding work in this field and won a lot of recognition. It's too technical for me to explain here, so I'll just move on to the next topic, which is much more intuitive, combinatorics and number theory. Combinatorics is about counting. It's the most natural thing. Number theory is properties of natural numbers. It was the field of Ramanujan. So one of the problems that has been explored for centuries and Ramanujan worked on is to count the number of integer partitions. For example, if you take the natural number 4, it can be partitioned in 5 ways. 4 is one partition, 1 plus 3 is another, 2 plus 2 is another, 1 plus 1 plus 2 is another, and finally 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, 4 ones is the fourth, the fifth one. So there are 5 ways to partition it. Question was, is there a closed form formula for the number of partitions of a number n? And Hardy and Ramanujan in the 1920s could find an approximation to that. And that has not really been improved in the last 100 years nearly. In our institute, they too had a different perspective on the whole thing. Our institute members, in collaboration with some people in the Indian Institute of Science and a foreigner, they could discover a fractal tree pattern in the way integer partitions are built. And that revealed a structure which is something like this. This is actually a fractal tree. It's not exactly the same tree that they discovered, something I picked from the web. So it's an infinite tree, but it is like self-similar. As you go inside and zoom in, it looks like the same tree replicating itself. And it shrinks as you go along, and that's why it looks like it's a finite tree. But towards the end, there are infinitely many points. And the fringe of the tree is like a limiting fringe. So the point about this slide was that mathematics is also about discovering interesting patterns. Fractal tree structure tells us about how integers can be partitioned. Moving on, algorithms is the foundations of computer science. And since computers are everywhere today, algorithms are also everywhere today. For example, motion planning. So suppose there is, under surveillance cameras on the border, an agent wants to move from point A to point B. A question could be, what is the shortest time in which he can move from point A to point B, disabling the smallest number of sensors? Because there are sensors that are surveilling that area. So it's an optimization problem. You want to travel in the shortest time possible and also disable as few sensors as possible. So such algorithmic problems have been studied in our algorithms group, and they've obtained very interesting results. Another area is a new area. It's called social choice algorithms. It's the field of algorithms penetrating management science, collective decision making. So for example, electoral systems have been analyzed, and people have tried to figure out what is the best protocol for conducting an election so that everybody's voice is, in the true sense, collectively heard. So decision making is more and more getting automated, and such algorithms. So here it's just an example of how to build an institution by hiring faculty, scientific staff, administrative staff, and with the gender balance and other social parameters in place so that we can have the right kind of skill sets. So an optimization problem which has to be modeled algorithmically, which can provide advice to the management to build such an institution. Moving on, another important field of research which is both foundational and technological is quantum communication and computation. Harnessing quantum mechanics is the next step to technology. It's going to bring about a technology revolution very soon. So in our institute, there is a small group working on quantum walks and quantum communication. And recently, we have taken a quantum walk algorithm designed here and run an actual physical simulation in University of Maryland in a collaborative work. Another piece of work is quantum communication protocols. Recently, China, and 3 years back, they made a huge breakthrough in quantum key sharing over by satellite communication over a distance of 1,200 kilometers. Now India has also set up a consortia of different institutions coming together, funded by DST. IMC is also part of that. The idea is to design similar key exchange protocols because these protocols are super secure and make communication really secure. Finally, I just want to say a few words which I mentioned earlier about the outreach and science communication program in the institute. We have a very dedicated bunch of people who are interested in reaching out to youngsters, teachers, as well as students at all levels. We have a calendar through the year having programs, instructional programs for school teachers, school students, workshops of various kinds. Both. You're right. Both. So when they come here, it's a more of a selective thing, and it's usually within Chennai or, you know, slightly outside Chennai. There are a few programs that are on larger scale, but usually it's confined to Tamil Nadu and in and around Chennai mainly. One event that I wanted to highlight is the Science at the Sabha. It's taking science as culture to the people, and it comes right after the music season in Chennai, and we use the Music Academy to conduct the program. In the last 5 years, it has been extremely successful, with each season attracting 1,000 participants. It spread over 4 hours. There are four talks, interaction with media, question-answer session with the people, and it has been a wonderful success so far. So with that, I'll end my presentation. Thank you, sir. So now is the time to felicitate our chief guest and other dignitaries on the dais. Let me wear my mask. I now request Dr. Arun Kumar Bhaduri, Distinguished Scientist, Director IGCAR, to deliver his address.
Respected Dr. M. Venkaiah Naidu, Honorable Vice President of India, through KP Anbalagan, Honorable Minister of Higher Education, Government of Tamil Nadu, Selvia Purva, IAS, Principal Secretary, Government of Tamil Nadu Higher Education Department, Professor Arvind, Director, Institute of Mathematical Sciences, colleagues from the Institute of Mathematical Sciences, the various units of the Department of Atomic Energy in and around Chennai, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Shri K. N. Vyas, Chairman, Atomic Energy Commission, and Secretary, Department of Atomic Energy, and on my own behalf, it's my privilege to extend a very warm welcome to you, sir, the Honorable Vice President of India, the Honorable Minister of Higher Education, Government of Tamil Nadu, and the Principal Secretary of Government of Tamil Nadu Higher Education Department, to this Institute of Mathematical Sciences, an autonomous institution under the Department of Atomic Energy. This institute, as Professor Arvind ably demonstrated to you technically, has had a very long tradition of application of mathematical sciences in all disciplines, be it physical sciences, chemical sciences, life sciences, engineering sciences, biosciences, and is indeed one of the institutes of pride of the Department of Atomic Energy. Honorable Vice President, sir, I would like to present before you in a short time the contributions and achievements that the Department of Atomic Energy, which has been and will continue to contribute to the services of the society in this part of the country and in Tamil Nadu. Apart from this institute in Chennai, the Department of Atomic Energy has units of the Nuclear Power Corporation of India at Kudungulam, the Nuclear Fuel Complex at Palaikal, and the Heavy Water Board unit at Thuthukudi, and a multi-unit facility at Kalpakkam, where I come from. In the power sector, the power plants at Kudungulam are presently producing 2,000 megawatts of electricity through its first two units. This, along with the two pressurized heavy water reactors at the Madras Atomic Power Station in Kalpakkam, makes the nuclear energy production in the state of Tamil Nadu, with installed capacity of 2,000, almost 500 megawatts electrical, among the highest, or probably the highest in any state in India. Sir, at Kalpakkam, which is a symbol of Atmanirbhar Bharat, the first two units of indigenously built 2,000 megawatt pressurized heavy water reactors were first set up. The first two in Rajasthan were set with Canadian collaborations. They walked out. We said, thank you, we did it ourselves. And were synchronized to the grid in 94 and 96. Similarly, in the Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research, the 40 megawatt thermal fast breeder test reactor, so you've been there in Kalpakkam, so you're aware, built in technical collaboration with CEA France, which also included, beyond the French design, the steam generator and the turbine built by the Bharat Heavy Electricals by Indian design, and has been operational till 1984. No test reactor in the world produces electricity. We produce electricity and feed it into the Tamil Nadu grid. Here again, the fuel, which was originally proposed to be supplied by France, did decline after the peaceful nuclear explosion at Pokhran. We said, never mind. Our colleagues at the Bhabha Atomic Research Center, Mumbai, developed an innovative fuel of uranium-plutonium mixed carbide, which has been the driver for fuel ever since 1984, and has achieved a burn-up of 165 megawatt days per ton. A Madras Atomic Power Station burn-up is about 10,000 megawatt days per ton. This is 165 gigawatt days per ton, a world record in the entire nuclear energy sector in the world. At Ajika Kalpakkam, the spent fuel from this fast reactor has been reprocessed, again by indigenous technology. The extracted plutonium has been refabricated as fuel at the Bhabha Atomic Research Center in Mumbai and has been put back into the reactor, demonstrating the closure of the fuel cycle for the second stage of a nuclear program. Again, sir, the first time any country has demonstrated this. In fact, no other country has demonstrated this so far. The BRC facilities, which also is based at Kalpakkam, reprocess the spent fuel from the Madras Atomic Power Station, again, based on fully indigenous technology developed at BRC Mumbai, including waste management and waste immobilization technologies, which nobody shares with us. These are fully homegrown. Sir, the Kalpakkam, as we discussed with you in the outside in the exhibition, is a unique site in the entire nuclear map of the world. It uses all the three fissile isotopes that can be used to generate power. The uranium-235 runs the Madras Atomic Power Station. The plutonium-239 is the driver fuel for the fast breeder test reactor. And the uranium-233, which is for the third stage of reactor, runs the Kalpakkam mini reactor, Kamini, the models of which we showed just now to you, sir. Sir, we in the Department of Atomic Energy have long been under severe, and I would stress severe technology denial regimes, because we wanted to have nuclear energy our way, which necessitated us from the very beginning to develop indigenously the science and technology related to all aspects of our nuclear power program. Therefore, Atmanirbhar Bharat, sir, truly has been in our blood from the very inception. And we are very proud that now that has become a national mission. We are already a part of it. We'll continue to be a part of it. In this regard, we are grateful, very grateful to the government of Tamil Nadu for providing all necessary support from the late 60s and the early 70s when this Kalpakkam site was started by our visionary chairman, Atomic Energy Commission, Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. He was the third chairman of Atomic Energy Commission and the founder, father of the space department. And the government of Tamil Nadu continues to provide us all the and all the other units of the Atomic Energy Department here at Tamil Nadu, and we are sure we'll get the similar support extended to us for the proposed India-based neutrino observatory INO at Theni. On 30th of October last year, 2020, on the 111th birthday of the founder, Dr. Homi Jahangir Baba, incubation centers were formally inaugurated by the present chairman, Sri Vyas, at BRC Mumbai, at IG Car Kalpakkam, at the Rajaramanna Center Advanced Technology Indore, the Variable Electron Cyclotron Center at Kolkata, and the Institute of Plasma Research at Ahmedabad, Gandhinagar, in line with the Atal Innovation Mission, where various societal application technologies which come as either spin-offs or intentionally created will be incubated and commercialized through MSMEs and startups. I would like to sum up, sir, assuring that we in the Department of Atomic Energy have been and will continue to develop fully indigenous technologies and continue to demonstrate our capabilities in the true spirit of Atmanirbhar Bharat. I would conclude, sir, by personally requesting you to visit us again at the unique site at Kalpakkam at your next convenience. Thank you again.
I now request Honorable Minister for Higher Education, Government of Tamil Nadu, Sir K.P. Anbaragan, to deliver his address.
Chennai Kanida Arivial Nirvanathil Nadaiperum Kalandaivu Mattum Pudhiya Kattidangal Thirappalavarku தலைமை விருந்தினராக வருகை புரிந்திருக்கும் மேதகு இந்திய குடியரசு துணை குடியரசுத் தலைவர் டாக்டர் எம் வெங்கையா நாயுடு அவர்களே, இவ்விழாவிற்கு சிறப்பு விருந்தினராக வருகை புரிந்திருக்கும் உயர்கல்வித்துறை முதன்மை செயலாளர் செல்வி அபூர்வா அவர்களே, கல்பாக்கம் அணு ஆராய்ச்சி நிலையத்தின் இயக்குனர் முனைவர் அருண்குமார் பாதிரி அவர்களே, வரவேற்புரை ஆற்றி அமர்ந்திருக்கும் கணித அறிவியல் நிறுவனத்தின் இயக்குனர் பேராசிரியர் வி அரவிந்த் அவர்களே, இறுதியாக நன்றியுரை வழங்க உள்ள கணித அறிவியல் நிறுவனத்தின் பதிவாளர் திரு எஸ் விஷ்ணு பிரசாத் அவர்களே, மேலும் இந்த நிகழ்வுகளை பங்கேற்றுக் கொண்டிருக்கக்கூடிய பேராசிரியர்களே, ஆசிரியர்களே, மாணவ மாணவர்களே, ஊடகத்துறை நண்பர்களே, உங்கள் அனைவருக்கும் என்னுடைய கனிவான வணக்கத்தை இந்த நேரத்திலே தெரிவித்துக் கொள்கின்றேன். ஐஎம்சி எனப்படும் கணித அறிவியல் நிறுவனமானது 1962 ஆண்டிலே அல்லாடி டி ராமகிருஷ்ணர் என்பவரால் நிறுவப்பட்டதாகும். இந்நிறுவனத்திற்கு 1974 ஆண்டு தமிழக அரசால் 4 ஏக்கர் நிலம் ஒதுக்கப்பட்டு தற்போது இது நிறுவனம் வளாகம் என்று அழைக்கப்படுகிறது. இந்நிறுவனம் தத்துவார்த்த இயற்பியல், கணிதம், தத்துவார்த்த கணினி அறிவியல் மற்றும் கணக்கீட்டு உயிரியல் ஆகிய துறைகளில் அடிப்படை ஆராய்ச்சிகளை மேற்கொள்ளும் ஒரு தன்னாட்சி தேசிய நிறுவனமாகும். இந்நிறுவனத்தில் செயல்படும் அறிவியல் நூலகம் தென்னிந்தியாவில் ஒரு பிராந்திய நூலகமாக விளங்கி வருகிறது. இந்நிறுவனம் ஒரு துடிப்பான கல்வி திட்டத்தை கொண்டுள்ள ஒரு நிறுவனமாகும். இந்நிறுவனம் அறிவியல் சார்ந்த பிஹெச்டி படிப்புகளை தன்னகத்தே கொண்டுள்ளது. ஐஎம்சி விந்திய முனைவர் பட்டத்தில் பிஹெச்டி பட்டங்களை பெறுவதற்கு ஏராளமான விஞ்ஞானிகளை ஆதரிக்கின்றது. வருகை தரும் விஞ்ஞானிகள் திட்டத்தையும் வழங்குகிறது. ஆண்டுதோறும் பல தேசிய மற்றும் சர்வதேச அறிவியல் கூட்டங்களை ஏற்பாடு செய்கிறது. ஐஎம்சி ஆனது பள்ளிகள், கல்லூரிகள் மற்றும் பொதுமக்களுக்கான பல்வேறு வளர்ச்சி பணிகளிலும் ஈடுபட்டு வருவது பாராட்டக்குரிய ஒன்றாகும். இவ்வாறு பல்வேறு பணிகளை செய்து வரும் இந்நிறுவனத்திற்கு ஆராய்ச்சி மற்றும் கல்வி தொடர்பான பணிகளுக்கு இந்திய அரசின் அணுசக்தி துறையும் மாண்புமிகு அம்மாவருடைய வழி தொடரும் தமிழக அரசும் பல வழிகளில் துணை புரிகிறது என்பதை இந்த நேரத்தில் குறிப்பிடுவதில் நான் மிக்க மகிழ்ச்சி அடைகின்றேன். இவ்வாறானது மேன்மேலும் பல ஆராய்ச்சிகளை மேற்கொண்டு மாணவர்களுக்கும் நாட்டு மக்களுக்கும் பயனுள்ள ஒரு அறிவியல் நிறுவனமாக திகழ வேண்டுமென வாழ்த்தி இவ்விழாவிற்கு ஏற்பாடுகள் செய்த அனைவருக்கும் நன்றி தெரிவித்து நிகழ்ச்சியில் கலந்து கொள்கின்ற வாய்ப்பை உருவாக்கிய அவர்களுக்கும் நன்றி தெரிவித்து விடைபெறுகிறேன். நன்றி, வணக்கம்.
Thank you, sir, for the encouraging words. Inspired by that, we'll try and do better and better in future. And now it's time for us to do the inauguration of the new residence wing. All you have to do is say something about it. So this is located in the DAE Nodal Center, which is in Pallavaram, about 14 kilometers from here, near the airport. And we're very grateful to Director Isikar and the civil engineering and electrical engineering wings of Isikar for their support through the project, for giving us the land also. So there are two blocks here. One is the hostel block, which is has 31 double rooms with all facilities, canteen and kitchen and so on. And it's on about 28,000 square feet floor area. And the other one is the PDF flatlet complex, which is the next slide. Is there one? Which is not shown here. There are 20, this is the one. It's 17,000 square feet, and there are essentially 24 PDF flatlets. Postdoctoral fellow flatlets, because they are people who are after PhD who need, probably are married and need some extra space. So this is the extra space that we have got, thanks to Isikar.
Sir, this also site has the South Regional Center for the Economic and Development Report, also as well as the Registration Office of
Yes, it's ready. It's ready for occupation. And now it's my pleasure to request Shri M. Venkaiah Naidu, Honorable Vice President of India, to deliver his address.
மரியாதைக்குரிய உயர் கல்வி மன்றம் வேளாண்மை அமைச்சர் திரு கே பி அம்பழகன் அவர்களே, உயர்கல்வித்துறை முதன்மை செயலாளர் திருமதி செல்வி அபூர்வா, இயக்குனர் ப்ரொஃபஸர் வி அரவிந்த், கதப்பாக்கம் ஐஜிசிஏஆர் இயக்குனர் டாக்டர் அருண்குமார் பௌதுரி, ஆராய்ச்சியாளர்கள், அனைத்து மாணவர்களுக்கும் அனைவருக்கும் மனமார்ந்த வணக்கம். இந்த விழாவில் நான் உங்களுடன் கலந்து கொள்வதில் மிக்க மகிழ்ச்சி அடைகிறேன். Friends, I really feel very happy that I am able to visit this famous historic institute, the Institute of Mathematical Science, Chennai. It's very energizing to physically interact with the faculty and students of this hallowed institution. I really feel very much enthused and become more confident the future of our nation because of the tremendous effort being put in by our scientists and the amount of knowledge and enthusiasm shown by the young researchers. My dear friends, this is part of my visit of a knowledge, I call it as a knowledge tour after I became vice president. Before that, I was in public life for more than 40 years, moving with people, talking, walking, spending time, meeting, greeting, and then having always interaction with the people. But after becoming vice president, you know, because of constitutional responsibility and there is an amount of protocol, you can't move as you like. You can't go to all places. So everything is decided in advance. And also there is a system. But I told my people, we should continue this, but in a different manner. So I have decided to go around the country and meet four segments of the society. Number one, visiting all the research institutes across the country, from Andaman to Jammu Kashmir. Research institutes of different kinds. Second, visiting universities across the country, IITs, IIITs, IISR, IIMs, like that. The third one is visiting farmers, agriculturists, fields, knowing about the research activity that is going on in ICAR, Krishi Vijnana Kendras, agriculture universities, and also field visit and interacting with the farming community to understand their problems, their challenges, and the new methods they themselves have invented, stressing the need about the lab to land. And next category is going around the country visiting various cultural bodies to understand the depth of our culture, heritage, and also to promote and propagate our culture, which is time-tested. We are an ancient civilization. We are talking of Mesopotamia, Babylonia, Egypt, Greece, Athens, all those civilizations. But our civilization, which is older, is surviving even today with all vibrancy. The reason is the knowledge given to us by our forefathers and also their desire to pass on that heritage to the next generation for the betterment of the humanity. Because we, India, Bharat, we believe in Vasudhaika Kutumbakam. Entire universe is one family. That is our philosophy. Of course, to begin with, we have to take care of ourselves, our surroundings, our states, and our country. But the end of it is welfare of the humanity. If you take care of the welfare of the humanity, humanity can live in peace. Peace is the prerequisite for progress. If you have tension, you cannot pay attention. So you have to work for the peace. Peace will come through progress. Peace will come through happiness of everybody. And then Everybody's desire is to have a peaceful, happy, healthier life, because mere wealth will not give you happiness. It is the wealth coupled with health and also the service, the sharing and caring. There, the happiness has to be shared. This is the philosophy of our civilization. So, my dear friends, youngsters, the purpose of my visit across the country to all these institutions is to understand the progress of research. And the purpose of research and science is to better the lives of the people. That is the purpose, ultimate aim. Betterment of the people's lives. People should live in harmony and happiness. So, this is the purpose of my visiting. And I might have covered maximum number of institutes. There are still number of institutes and also much progress, changes have come, and then I would like to visit some of them second time. The director was telling about making a request about visiting Kalpakkam again, because new research, new innovations are coming up. So one must be abreast with the latest developments of the country. Everybody in life, I believe in the philosophy, everybody in life must go on learning, learning, learning. Not earning alone, learning. And then coupled that with share and care. That is the purpose. And also to enthuse the people who are working in various fields, the researchers, the youngsters. By visiting the Vice President, visiting the institutes, one, his knowledge is improved. Second is, the people who are working in the institutes, they also get enthused and encouraged. Appreciation, understanding and appreciation is very much required. That's why yesterday I tweeted about the vaccine, Indian-made vaccine. The entire country, people are elated. They are very happy because it's a big leap in science. As we continue to fight against COVID and maintain safe distancing, we have also come to appreciate the value of real relationship and the real interactions in our lives. I am hopeful that this event is a sign of better things to come. And I wish you all a happy, prosperous, healthy, safe, and most importantly, a peaceful New Year. My dear sisters and brothers, the great German mathematician Gauss has often quoted as saying, "Mathematics is the queen of sciences." Mathematics is perhaps the main driving force behind the scientific discoveries. Indeed, the progress of human civilization over the ages can be marked by the corresponding progress in mathematical thought and discovery. India has a rich history of practicing mathematics since ancient times. We had stalwarts like Aryabhatta, Varahamihira, Brahmagupta, who made discoveries and used algebraic techniques that were well ahead of the rest of the world. The earliest source on Indian mathematics was the Sulabha Sutras from the Vedic period. Sutras like Apastamba and Baudhayana contain the geometric details for construction of sacrificial altars and for the other rituals. In the spirit of our philosophy of share and care, our knowledge was shared. Our numerals were borrowed by Arab traders, which later spread to medieval Europe and are now known as Hindu-Arabic numeral systems. Acknowledging these contributions, Albert Einstein once said, quote, "We owe a lot to the Indians who taught us how to count, without which no worthwhile scientific discovery could have been made," unquote. The other day, I was going through a calendar, new calendar, developed by students of IIT Kharagpur. Who said what about India and its knowledge? Various experts across the globe, their quotations and all. This rich legacy in mathematics continued in modern times too. The great Indian mathematician Ramanujamji has captured the imagination of the people world over. With almost no formal training, he made important contributions to mathematical analysis and number theory without employment and living in the, at that time, in ordinary conditions. He continued his work undeterred. Finally, only one English mathematician, G.H. Hardy, noted his work. Ramanujamji was able to travel to Cambridge, England, and became one of the youngest fellows of the Royal Society. Hardy considered that Ramanujam's genius could only be compared to the mathematical greats like Leonhard Euler. In a short but eventful life, Sri Ramanujam produced nearly 4,000 amazing original results. His notes had original theorems that took years for other mathematicians to prove. His genius of looking at the speciality in each number is unmatched and legendary. His inspirational story must motivate us to discover many more Ramanujams in our children. Always remember, there is no dearth of talent in India. This land, this soil, this water, this air, this civilization has something special. There is inherent knowledge. What you need to do is identify, encourage, and promote, then you will. That's how it explains about the Indian companies coming out with this vaccination in such a short span of time. Mathematics and science are subjects are enticing, exciting, and invigorating to the human mind. But more than just being numbers and tool for finding new discoveries, they have more importantly been the lifeline of human progress. Thus, mathematics and science can bring innovations that will make the common man's life more comfortable. My dear brothers and sisters, we all know that mathematics is introduced at a very young age in our school curriculum. It is deemed as part of the child's basic or elementary education. Unfortunately, many children get intimidated by the subject and simply develop fear and anxiety at the prospect of learning mathematics. Therefore, the method of teaching plays a critical role in making children passionate about maths. An important issue that needs to be addressed is rote memorization, even in mathematics. Many a time, children simply memorize the answer from a textbook and reproduce it in the exams. This has to be stopped, and the child must be trained to think creatively and analytically. Undoubtedly, better teaching training and revamped curriculum are crucial to revitalize prime education. Nowadays, we are not allowing children to think innovatively. We are not giving that much time. And with this advent of new technology, of course, which is useful undoubtedly, children, you ask them anything, they try to go to the net. And then Google. That's why I'm suggesting nowadays children should use telephone sparingly in a useful manner rather than continuously being busy with the phone prone to many diseases and problems. Disease means other diseases, I'm not talking the medical diseases. Most of the time, what is there? Nothing, yes. And with the advent of social media, you know what is all appearing in WhatsApp, in phone, and its messages added to the modern cinema, where values, culture, heritage, family systems are all being slowly compromised and eroded. Telephone is definitely very useful. Even we use also telephone, but over-utilizing. Second is about preoccupation with the screen. Most of the time, your mind is captured. You are not allowed to think. So innovation. That's why the gurus, the teachers, they have a greater responsibility in arousing creativeness among the children while teaching, rather than simply going by textbook alone. The educators must adopt creative methods to invigorate young minds. Puzzles, demonstrations, and other hands-on activity could be utilized to make children become friends with the numbers. A pedantic manner of teaching should be replaced with more interactive and inclusive method. The new education policy seeks to do away with rigid separation between arts and sciences. Curricular and extracurricular and vocational and academic streams. This is also very, very important. When we were students, I remember, we used to have compulsory PT class, physical training, which is missing nowadays. And also Air Wing, NCC, other courses where discipline and nationalism, thinking about the country, was aroused among the children. And secondly, there used to be craft class. Crafts, various crafts, they used to be taught, and children used to develop some aptitude, interest. And thirdly, we used to have a gardening class. Gardening, to be friendly with nature. Nature, preservation of nature is very important. The COVID lesson we must understand. How to be friendly with nature. Don't play with nature. That will play with you. It's playing already. The so-called climate change is real now. And the challenges thrown up by climate change is having negative effects on the life of the people. So nature, that's why I say nature, culture, together for a better future. You must preserve your nature and also culture. for a better future. And also the need for physical fitness. And also we used to have a moral science. Now science reminds, morals are not stressed. This is really disheartening. We have to go back to our roots of our teaching and add the new technology, new methods to that. But the basic values, the foundations, they should not be compromised. Comparatively, why India fared better, according to my understanding, so-called advanced countries, how they are affected, the pandemic. India with huge population and also economic the variations and all. Still, and please note, do some research. Why the farmers, why the rural people are not affected much in the pandemic? They spend more time in open. They are friendly with sun, not their sons, sun, air, plants, and also work. Endurance comes through work, hard work. Not that people in urban areas, they work in air-conditioned rooms, closed doors, no physical activity at all, no enjoyment of the nature. So that's one of the reasons, as I could understand. Otherwise, the results would have been catastrophic. So we have to focus on being friendly with the nature. Everybody, including scientists, and everybody. Second is physical fitness. Our children should be motivated about the importance of physical fitness. Physically fit, then mentally alert. That's why this yoga or any other physical activity or cycling, that will reduce pollution also. And then make you physically fit and mentally alert. And also, one more aspect is the food. The Indian food is mostly time-tested. It is decided as per the season. Rutu, season, what to be eaten in winter, summer, different seasons, our people, thousands, and there are thousands of varieties, but unfortunately our children are getting tempted because of this advertisement and also brand showcasing by some icons of society and all. Then when I asked boys, "Boy, what is there, what are you?" They said, "Sir, nowadays it is instant food. Instant food." I said, "Instant food means constant disease. Try to understand this. Food has to be properly cooked and eaten. And there is no dearth of food varieties in India. But that too, I mean, Tamil Nadu. Oh, amazing varieties. From more Kolambu to Worth Kolambu. From Chettinadu chicken to Mini sambar, all this. And there is a craze for our food across the globe. And we are running behind pizzas, burgers. They may be suitable to their temperature and their conditions, those countries. I don't want to quarrel with them on that. But Indian conditions, for us, it does no good at all. So eating proteinous food, that is more important. Not the junk food. This is also important. This new education policy focuses on the ending away the rigid separation between arts and science, curricular and extracurricular activities, vocational and academic streams, how to combine them. I am very happy about it. We must fully capitalize on this vision document. Document prepared by Sri Kasturi Rangan and others, and bring in pedagogical changes that will ignite the passion of the young masters in subjects like mathematics. Foundational mathematics and science form the basis of for STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics education. We must nurture and encourage children to make up and take up their careers in society. Any country that aspires to be in the forefront of human knowledge needs to invest in fundamental scientific research, including mathematics. This is my understanding. In order to strengthen the STEM education, we must look beyond government funding. The private sector has also an equal opportunity and responsibility to fund and partner with institutions and to collaborate on STEM projects. Private-public partnership is also in need of the hour. This is the global practice now, which has been bringing a lot of benefits for the investors too. Easy IP and patenting regime will also go a long way in encouraging STEM research, and the government has been taking many initiatives in this regard. The Prime Minister gave a three-line mantra. He said, reform, perform, and transform. Transformation of the lives of the people. My dear sisters and brothers and youngsters particularly, a major issue of concern in STEM-related employment is under-representation of women. While about 40% of STEM graduates in India are women, which is the highest in the world, women's share in STEM jobs in India is mere 14%. Even more worrisome is the poor women's participation in postgraduate and doctoral studies. This needs to be encouraged. The women pay more attention. No deviation. That has been proven. Gargayi, Maitreyi, even Vedic times, women were in the forefront. And in between, we started neglecting this women's education. Now, of course, when I go around the universities for attending convocation and all, a welcoming trend is that the Vice President gives awards for 10, 15, 20, 30 people. All other degrees are awarded by the Governor or the Minister or the Chancellors and Vice Chancellors. So among these recipients of the gold medals, top rankers, happy to note, 60% are girls. That's a positive trend needs to be encouraged. And the need of the hour is to bridge the gender divide in employment. We must look at the cause for this dismal underrepresentation of the woman in science and technology jobs and take steps to rectify the situation expeditiously. I'm happy there are some woman researchers here and also on the dials also. Number of girl students in IITs, which was just 8% in 2016, has increased to nearly 20%. A very welcoming trend. The Department of Science and Technology's Women Scientist Program is a laudable initiative that encourages women to take up careers in science and math. We must celebrate our women scientists and mathematicians and showcase them as role models to our young girls so that we can discover many more talented and hidden Asima Chatterjee's, Janaki Ammals, and Sekundra Devis. Mathematics and statistics were once looked at as niche fields of research and were not popular career domains. Much has changed in the past few years. There has been a revolutionary change in the way business is done with the advent of data science and data-driven decision making. This was aided by advancement in computing facilities and the emergence of artificial intelligence. Now the mathematical modeling and statistical analysis have become an indispensable skill set in many industries. This field is only expected to grow in the coming years as more and more business, governments and other organizations seek to leverage the power of data. Our young demography and a growing economy imply that there is both increasing demand for work and skilled workforce. In this context, data science is an important area that needs to be fully tapped in ensuing job creation. We must look beyond our traditional science and engineering curricula and must equip young graduates with these new skill sets, else they will become outdated and the degree will remain only on paper. For this, institutes such as yours and others could offer micro courses in statistics, computer science and related subjects. The proliferation of distance education courses offered by national institutes like IITs is a good augury, but most of these courses are still in English. That's another problem. We need to offer them in local languages, national languages, so that more students get benefited from such courses. I am not saying don't learn English. Learn English, French, Russian, and even learn Hindi. There should not be any opposition to Hindi. It should not be, that's why I say, no imposition and no opposition. That should be the position. No language should be imposed on people. And no language should be opposed, particularly Indian languages. You must learn as many languages as possible to improve your knowledge. And English also is useful for international this thing and all. You go through the life of many scientists, many great leaders, they first start with mother tongue. And we have a mistaken impression. Otherwise, if you don't know English, you will not go up. Everybody will go up. For that, there is no language limitation. The other up. I'm talking in a lighter sense. But learning English is useful. There is no doubt about it. And as many languages as. But to start with, children must be taught in mother tongue. This is my strong opinion. And I have been talking to everybody, speaking about the same. Because the child's mind, in tender age, the language which he has learned from mother's womb, if you are able to communicate in that language, the boy or the girl catches up easily. And then you can really teach them in other languages also. My dear brothers and sisters, this institute was, as explained, was founded in 1962 as a National Institute of Higher Learning to pursue quality fundamental research. I must say it has done understandingly well in research and is well recognized both nationally and globally. I am aware that this institute is also involved with the proposed mega science project called India-based Neutrino Observatory. This project aims to build a world-class underground lab close to Madurai to study the exotic and elusive particles called neutrinos. The detectors to be located there, we built indigenously, it was explained to me, everything is going to be built indigenously. With active participation from industry, there will be a lot of positive takeaways from this ambitious project. And it will elevate India's global position as a leader in scientific research. I am pleased to note that research is being undertaken by the institute in other important areas like quantum computing, condensed matter physics, and high energy physics. I must also compliment this institute for contributing to the growth of science in Tamil Nadu through various research collaborations and science outreach programs like Science at the Sabha, a beautiful concept, but it should be more popular. It should be carried to the people. Ultimately, what is the purpose, as we have been telling, is to benefit the people. So you should do more and more sabhas. I would like to congratulate and compliment all the people who are responsible for the growth of this institute. And I convey my best wishes to all the people who are doing research here. And my pongal Sankranti. Greetings to all of you, 2021. We hope the darkness will end and we'll all be able to move towards progress and live in a happy, healthy atmosphere. I wish you all the best. I'm also happy to have virtually inaugurated the new residential wing of the campus. My best wishes to the Institute fraternity for all future endeavors. May you continue to find magic in numbers. May the country prosper, guided by science and reason. May we all collectively thrive in this new world. Thank you very much. Vanakkam. Nandri.
Thank you, sir, for a wonderful speech. You shared with us so many thoughts on starting with mathematics, research in mathematics and sciences, and across topics like primary education and many other aspects of education. Thank you very much, sir. Very thought-provoking speech. And now, I would like to request our registrar, Sri Vishnu Prasad, to deliver his vote of thanks. He's been the workhorse behind this event. Words of thanks.
Thank you, sir, for your inspiring speech. Today's chief guest, Honorable Vice President of India, Shri M. Venkaya Naidu Garu, Thiru K.P. Anbalagan Avargal, Honorable Minister for Higher Education, Government of Tamil Nadu, and Chairman, Governing Board of IMSC, Distinguished Guest, Shelvi Apurva, Principal Secretary to Government of Tamil Nadu, Higher Education Department, and Member, Governing Board and Executive Council of IMSC, Respected Dr. Arun Kumar Bhadriji, Director IGCR Kalpakkam, and Respected Professor V. Arvind, Faculty Members, Non-Academic Staff Members, and dear research scholars of IMSC, members of the press, electronic media, ladies and gentlemen. It is my proud privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this August occasion during the Honorable Vice President of India to IMSC. I take this opportunity to express our profuse gratitude to you for your esteemed presence amongst us and for presiding over the function. The valuable thoughts that you have expressed on this occasion will no doubt serve our institute in good step as we entered into 59th year of our institute, as this institute was founded on 3rd January 1962. Sir, we are honored for having planted a tree to our campus as part of our continuous efforts to make the campus green. This way, we're very much nearing the nature, sir. Inauguration of the new residential wing at DA Nodal Center Pallavaram really added additional infrastructure facility to the institute. We are thankful to the Department of Atomic Energy for their visionary decision and magnanimity in sanctioning the grants for the above infrastructure facility. We convey our gratitude and heartfelt thanks to Honorable Minister for Higher Education for accepting our invitation and consenting to come to our institute to be with us today. Sir, we are very thankful to you for your continuous support. The speech delivered by Dr. Arun Kumar Bhadriji has truly set the benchmark for his series of resourceful support to IMSC. We are deeply indebted to Selvi Apurvaji, member of the Governing Board and Executive Council of IMSC, for extending continuous support of the Government of Tamil Nadu towards the growth of the institute. Madam, our sincere thanks to you for your gracious presence amongst us today. The exhibitions displayed by IGCR, INO exhibition and the permanent exhibition of IMSC projecting the growth of the institute from its inception are indeed results of hard work of each and everyone involved in the areas displayed therein. Our sincere thanks to all those who are behind the success. The welcome speech of Professor V. Aravind, Director IMSC, explained the academic and research activities of IMSC. It is my privilege to thank the director for all guidance and freedom given to academicians and non-academicians of the institute to progress. Our special thanks to all the dignitaries, guests in the audience who spared their valuable time to be with us on this morning. Our special thanks to staff of systems divisions, electrical engineering division, civil engineering division, non-academic project staff of IMSC who have supported us beyond their routine duty hours and besides COVID guidelines of government. Our thanks to the corporation authorities, security personnel, police authorities, especially internal and external technicians, including garden, lawn maintenance staff, security and housekeeping staff for their fullest support in maintaining the surroundings of the institute clean and green. I finally solicit continuous support from all the dignitaries from Dias for the growth of the institute. Thank you very much.